It was on the 15th of February 1942 that British High Command began to receive the first scarcely credible reports from the Pacific. The reports confirmed that Singapore, Britain's Gibraltar of the East, had fallen into the hands of the Japanese. What was more, 130,000 men, under the command of General Percival, had also surrendered to General Yamashita's forces, as in little more than a week, the Japanese had seized one of the British Empire's most prized possessions. As usual, a somber Winston Churchill reflected the mood of the country when he described the loss of Singapore as the greatest disaster and capitulation in British history. On the 7th of December, 1941, Japan made its infamous attack on the US Pacific Fleet at Pearl Harbor on the island of Hawaii. The attack was no isolated adventure. It was part of a carefully planned strategy that had as its objective the conquest of Southeast Asia. Malaya was a strategically and economically vital bastion of the British Empire. At that time, the Malay states provided more than half the world's tin ore and natural rubber, and they had been identified by the Japanese as territories vital to their expansion in the region as far back as 1938, in the now infamous Greater East Asia Co-Prosperity Sphere. It was this crucial area that Japan intended to conquer, with the final prize being at the very southern tip of Malaya, the historic British fortress at Singapore. Nothing was left to chance. Japan's network of imperial agents worked feverishly during the summer of 1941 to provide detailed information on the region's defenses to the military, who planned a huge air, land, and sea invasion during the early months of 1942. Japanese High Command had long since concluded that the conquest of Malaya and the capture of Singapore could not be achieved by an assault on the fortress from the sea. For the British had strengthened Singapore's defenses with enormous 15-inch guns. It was decided instead to attack by the back door, an overland assault from the north that would take the Japanese forces down through Malaya and into Singapore. Plans were therefore drawn up for landings to be launched from the Gulf of Siam, which would put troops ashore at Patani, Singora, and Kota Baru. The Japanese also planned to advance through the dense Malayan jungle and to hook up behind the British forces that they knew would be expecting an attack by road. Like the attack on Pearl Harbor, the Japanese realized that the element of surprise was crucial to the success of the whole ambitious operation, and it was decided not to carry out preliminary bombardments of the landing positions. It was a sign of the confidence of the Japanese that the plan allowed only 100 days to secure victory. In the event, it was achieved in only 70. The British strategy for the Far East was centered on the defense of Singapore itself. Huge amounts of money, some £60 million, had been spent on strengthening the fortress there, and the project had become something of a political hot potato during the 1930s. Despite work starting, stopping, and restarting several times, the Changi Naval Base was finally completed in 1938. As we have already seen, the defences at Singapore had been constructed solely to withstand an invasion from the sea. Alongside the massive 15-inch gun emplacements, four airfields were also constructed. And there is no doubt that the Changi Naval Base was considered by British High Command to be impregnable to seaborne attack. Unfortunately, fewer provisions had been made for an attack on the base by land, the dangers of which had been clearly pointed out in a report sent to British Chiefs of Staff as long ago as 1937. The recommendations in the report were ignored. It would prove to be a costly mistake. Like the Americans at Pearl Harbor, the British cause was not helped by a general lack of respect for the fighting capabilities of the Japanese. The British also believed that it would be impossible for the Japanese to launch a surprise attack from the sea, simply because Japan was so far away. They also reasoned that if an attack did come, they would also be able to rely on help from the US Pacific Fleet in Hawaii. All these factors combined to produce a sense of complacency at the Changi base that the Japanese were quick to exploit. In command of the Japanese 25th Army was Tomoyuki Yamashita, a highly regarded leader who, through his exploits, earned the nickname the Tiger of Malaya. A superb strategist, Yamashita had been sent on a special military mission to Germany and Italy in 1940, during which he had meetings with Hitler and Mussolini. He returned to Japan with severe misgivings about any war with the US or Britain, which he felt should be postponed until Japan had thoroughly modernized its army and air force. That view did not match with the nationalist fervor and mood for action that swept through pre-war Japan. A fine leader of men, Renta Mutoguchi had progressed steadily through the ranks of the Japanese army since his graduation from military academy in 1910. After promotion from the position of Yamashita's chief of staff, he was given command of the 18th Division, then stationed in China. It was this division which performed so well under Mutoguchi's leadership during the Malaya and Singapore campaign. Arthur Percival had been commander of the British forces in Malaya since July 1941. After a distinguished career, during which he had served as a divisional commander in Britain and General Dill's chief of staff in France. The problems facing him, as the Japanese poured into Malaya, though, were different from any he had confronted before. Suddenly, he was placed in charge of poorly prepared troops that were being asked to repulse a confident, highly motivated, and determined enemy. If Percival was to prove unequal to the task, it was questionable whether any Allied general, given the same resources, would have been capable of shielding Malaya and Singapore from the Japanese invaders. Henry Gordon Bennett served in the First World War, ending it with the rank of Brigadier General, and was appointed General Officer commanding Australian Imperial Forces in Malaya in 1941. These forces were stationed at first at Johor, under the umbrella of the Australian 8th Division. Under Bennett's command, the Australians were responsible for some courageous delaying actions as the Japanese advanced through Malaya, particularly at the River Moire in January 1942. Bennett's style of leadership, however, attracted much criticism during and after the Malaya campaign and the fall of Singapore. Sir Robert Brooke Popham had retired from active service in 1937 to become governor of Kenya, but he was recalled and appointed commander of British forces in the Far East. He inherited an area chronically short of aircraft and in poor shape for aerial defence. But Brooke Popham was unable to convince High Command in London of the seriousness of the situation. A recommendation to annex Siam, which would have made the Japanese invasion of Malaysia much more difficult, also went unheeded. And Brooke Popham's replacement had already been appointed when the Japanese forces themselves arrived there in December 1941. An excellent leader of men, Lewis Heath commanded the Indian forces present during the invasion of Malaya and the struggle for Singapore. Heath was a fine tactician and strategist who had spent most of his military career on the northwest frontier of India. Heath had a difficult relationship with Percival, who did not share his confidence in the ability of Indian troops, or have any great faith in Heath's abilities as a commander. The three divisions of the Japanese 25th Army that marched through Malaya and into Singapore were among the finest that Japan had to offer. Superbly supported by the 22nd Air Flotilla and the 11th Air Fleet, the army was organized along similar lines to the German Wehrmacht that had stormed across Europe during 1939 and 1940. Field commanders were expected to make decisions during battle without reference to their high command, an innovation which helped Japanese forces exploit local successes quickly and win victories, often over numerically superior and better equipped enemies. Capably led and bolstered by the support of 200 tanks, these Japanese forces were fearsome opponents who made full use of several unusual tactics, including advancing through southern Malaya on an enormous fleet of bicycles. Their professionalism belied both their limited weaponry and equipment and the army's relatively small size. The British and Empire troops that were expected to face the crack divisions of the Japanese army were poorly prepared and under-trained. The Far East was hardly a British priority in late 1941. That honor fell to the Middle East, and in particular North Africa. And while the British troops lacked nothing in courage, they were simply not prepared for the region's climate and conditions. Despite being bolstered by troops from India and Australia, the British forces had little chance of holding the Japanese army. Indeed, one historian concluded after the war that it was General Percival's great misfortune to preside over a hopeless campaign with an ill-equipped and wrongly trained army. And it's difficult to see how British High Command can have been surprised at events as they unfolded. Completely let down by pre-war politicians, with dubious motivations and peacetime agendas, the army was cast adrift to fend for itself now that war had come, a hapless victim of political ignorance and indifference. Unlike most of the other nations involved in the escalating conflict around the world, the Japanese viewed the tank as an infantry support weapon. Unable to imagine its use as an independent strike weapon, or envisage a situation in which it would engage enemy tanks head-on, the Japanese designed their tanks with very light armor for maximum mobility. Although equipped with much smaller guns than US and British tanks, some Japanese tanks had the unusual design feature of a rear-facing machine gun. The Japanese would later discover to their cost that while these tanks were very effective at supporting infantry on the offensive, they were of less help in defensive positions. They would suffer dreadfully at the hands of bigger Allied tanks during the last years of the war. The Type 89B weighed 11.5 tons and was crewed by a team of four men. Introduced in 1934, it was powered by a six-cylinder Mitsubishi diesel engine that provided a top speed of 17 miles per hour, and it was protected by armor a mere 17 millimeters thick. The Type 89B was equipped by a 57mm forward-facing gun and a 6.5mm rear-facing machine gun, both of which were situated in the turret, and there was a further gun in the hull. The Type 89B was also employed by the Japanese Navy and used in amphibious landings. With a three-man crew, protected by 12mm armor, the Type 95 was a steady and reliable performer that was used extensively during the Japanese campaign in China in the 1930s. It was equipped by a 37mm turret-mounted gun and a 6.5mm hull-mounted machine gun. The machine weighed in at 7.5 tons. Introduced in 1935, the Type 95 was powered by a Mitsubishi six-cylinder engine that gave a top speed of 28 miles per hour. Japanese High Command quickly identified the need for an effective long-range bomber aircraft if the campaign in the Pacific was to be successful. And the G4M1 was introduced to fulfill the role in 1941. It was powered by two Mitsubishi 14-cylinder engines that gave a top speed of 265 miles per hour. With a maximum range of over 3,000 miles, the G4M1 was armed with 20mm cannon and 7.7mm machine guns. The aircraft could carry 1,000 kilograms of external bombs or one 1,764-pound torpedo. The G4M1's relatively light armaments and less than sturdy build, however, made the plane prey to enemy attack. The main weapons at the British base in Singapore were the enormous 15-inch coastal guns. These were supported by six 9.2-inch guns, a number of 6-inch guns, 3.7-inch anti-aircraft guns, and a range of machine gun emplacements. Also sent to Singapore, with orders to impede the expected Japanese landings, were the battleships Repulse and the Prince of Wales, sailing under the codename Force Z. Extensive use was also made of reconnaissance aircraft by British forces in the region. Among the reconnaissance aircraft which saw action in Singapore were the Consolidated Catalina flying boat and the Bristol Blenheim. But the best was probably the Lockheed Hudson, which was introduced in 1939. Powered by two Wright Cyclone nine-cylinder engines, the Lockheed Hudson had a top speed of 222 miles per hour and an operational range of 1,960 miles. The aircraft was armed with 0.303 inch machine guns and had an internal load capacity of 1,350 pounds. The Prince of Wales was one of the most modern battleships in the entire Royal Navy, having only been at sea since May 1941. It weighed 43,000 tons and could travel at speeds of up to 28 knots. The Prince of Wales was equipped with a formidable array of armaments that included 10 14-inch guns, 16 5.25 inch guns, and 32 2-pounder guns. The battleship carried a crew of more than 1,400 men. In contrast to the Prince of Wales, HMS Repulse was a proud veteran of the First World War. She was a battle cruiser that weighed 35,000 tons and carried a crew of 1,309 men. With a top speed of 29 knots, her thin armor was protected by six 15-inch guns and a series of 4-inch guns. Although the Repulse was considered a fast, capable ship, she was to prove no match for the Japanese torpedo bombers that swooped down on her during the battle for Singapore. The Japanese attack was launched from Indochina, and the battle was directed by Yamashita from the island of Hainan. The Japanese commander had originally been offered five divisions by high command, but eventually accepted only three. The 5th Division, under Lieutenant General Matsui, Lieutenant General Mutaguchi's 18th Division, and the Imperial Guards Division, commanded by Lieutenant General Nishimura. The 56th Division was held in reserve, but it was not needed. The 5th and 18th Divisions sailed from Hainan in 19 transports, closely supported by the four cruisers of the 7th Cruiser Squadron and the two battleships, two cruisers, and destroyer escorts of Southern Force. In all, 60,000 Japanese troops, 200 tanks, and 610 aircraft set off for their rendezvous point in the Gulf of Siam, from where they would begin the attack that would eventually lead to the capture of Singapore. The British Naval Squadron Force Z arrived in Singapore on the 2nd of December 1941, sailing under the command of Admiral Phillips. It consisted of the battleships Repulse and Prince of Wales and the destroyers Electra, Express, Tenedos, and Vampire. But the squadron had been allocated no air support and was missing the carrier Indomitable, which had been damaged and was unable to sail. On land, the Malaya Command, under Lieutenant Percival, consisted of the 1st and 2nd Malaya Infantry Brigade and the 12th Indian Brigade. The 8th Australian Division came under the command of Major General Bennett, and the 3rd Indian Corps were commanded by Lieutenant General Heath. The defence of Malaya and Singapore was therefore entrusted to 130,000 men armed with 450 guns and 110 aircraft. Although the army was able to make use of a number of armored cars, no tanks were available for use against the Japanese invasion force. It was in the early hours of the 8th of December 1941, not yet 24 hours since the dramatic events at Pearl Harbor, that the Japanese made their landings to the north of Malaya. There were three landing sites. The first, at Kota Baru, acted as a diversion for the main landings to the north at Singora and Patani. But it was not long before these main forces had driven to the south and expelled the 9th Indian Division from Kota Baru itself. At the same time, the first waves of Japanese bombers attacked the island of Singapore to the far south, attacks for which the island was completely unprepared. Bombs also fell upon exposed airfields, and many British aircraft were destroyed. Now, the Japanese forces in Malaya began their rapid progress towards the south of the country. At sea, disaster also struck. Alerted to the Japanese fleet sailing towards Malaya, Force Z had left Singapore on the 8th of December, protected by appalling weather. It was not long, however, before the weather cleared and the British ships were spotted by Japanese aircraft. Admiral Phillips, aboard the Prince of Wales, realized the danger to the fleet and tried to return to Singapore via Kuantan. But on the 10th of December, they were caught on the open seas by Japanese bomber aircraft. The bombs and torpedoes rained down upon the Repulse and the Prince of Wales, both of which received multiple hits. It was not long before the two huge vessels were sinking beneath the waves, leaving the destroyer escorts to pick up more than 2,000 survivors. A total of 850 men aboard the two ships were killed, among them Admiral Phillips himself. It was the first time in history that capital ships had been sunk from the air. And the loss of Force Z tragically proved to British High Command the folly of sending ships into battle without air support. It was a hard lesson learned. For now, the Japanese had gained control of the seas surrounding Malaya and Singapore. Meanwhile, on land, the town of Jitra fell to the Japanese on the 12th of December, forcing the troops of the 11th Indian Division to retreat further south towards Gurun and Kraw. The pattern was now set. It was one of bitter fighting and brave but futile resistance by the British and Empire forces. On the 14th of December, the Japanese drove Indian troops from the town of Kraw. Gurun fell the following day. It was now clear to Percival that the only option for his troops was an orderly tactical withdrawal to the south of Malaya. But the swift Japanese outflanking advances made through the thick jungle made this virtually impossible. The Japanese rammed home their advantage with stinging attacks from the air, and very soon the orderly withdrawal turned into chaotic retreat. In less than 10 days fighting, the Japanese advanced more than 100 miles over difficult, mountainous terrain. The month of December ended much as it had begun. Lieutenant General Heath tried in vain to rally his increasingly demoralized and disorganized men in an attempt to halt the Japanese advance at the Perak River. The gallant men of the 3rd Indian Division were simply no match for their aggressive enemy, however, and they were eventually overrun, leaving High Command looking nervously over their shoulders at Kuala Lumpur, the Malayan capital. The only hope of preventing its capture was for the Japanese invasion to be contained in the north. But it was obvious that a firm foothold had been gained, and it would now take an extraordinary effort to stop them. For the Japanese, the next major prize was already in sight. It was the town of Kampar, which lay invitingly on the main road south. Heath's 3rd Division did their best to prepare its defences and waited once more for the inevitable Japanese attack. It was not long in coming. On New Year's Day 1942, the Japanese hurled themselves on the town while simultaneously moving troops by sea down the west coast of Malaya in order to hook up behind the 3rd Division's position. Once more, the successful outflanking manoeuvre was carried out to perfection, although Heath's brave defenders did manage to halt the Japanese advance for a few brief hours. The fighting was bitter and bloody, and on the 2nd of January, the 3rd Indian Division was forced to withdraw towards new positions at Slim River. If the battle was going badly for the British on the west coast, there was no news to cheer them from the east coast either. After the British abandonment of the Kotobaru airfield, the Japanese invaders had pressed home their advance down the sparsely populated coast, where the British troops were given long stretches of coastline to defend. What was more, the British defenders were also stretched out thinly, and their unhappy circumstances were not helped by the twin devils of poor communication and contradictory orders from the Malaya command. As a consequence, Gong Kedah, Kuala Trengganu, and Kuala Dungun all fell to the Japanese between the 8th and the 30th of December, and by New Year's Day, the vital town of Kuantan, with its huge airfield, was also in Japanese hands. Expelled from Kuantan, the 9th Division faced a long forced march to Jerantut, in the middle of the country to the north of Kuala Lumpur, where they hoped to link up with the British forces currently fighting on the west coast. With the fall of Kuantan, the Japanese had captured more than half of Malaya in less than 1 month. If speed and mobility were the key factors in the relentless Japanese advance south, another tactical innovation also helped to keep them one step ahead of the British troops. The humble bicycle, employed in huge fleets, bore entire Japanese regiments noiselessly along roads and through jungles, thus adding another vital element to their tactical superiority over the British: surprise. As the British withdrew from defensive position to defensive position, there was simply no time to prepare for the relentless Japanese attacks. On the 3rd of January, the Japanese smashed into the positions held by the 11th Indian Division on the Slim River and completely overwhelmed them. nothing could now prevent the Japanese from capturing the Malayan capital of Kuala Lumpur. A dilemma now faced Percival and his fellow commanders. Should an attempt be made to halt the Japanese advance in the streets of the capital, or should a further withdrawal be made to Gemas, where the converging roads and narrowing countryside might offer a better chance of success? It was quickly decided that a stand at Gemas, in the Johor region of southern Malaya, would give the increasingly tired and dispirited British and Empire troops their best opportunity to stop the Japanese. Kuala Lumpur was abandoned. There was one more consideration that was uppermost in the minds of British High Command and of the British government at home. With every yard of ground gained by the Japanese, with every village or town taken, Singapore itself came under increasing threat. If the situation in Malaya was bad enough, the loss of Britain's prize Far Eastern possession was unthinkable. Try as they might, however, the troops at Gemas could not halt the Japanese. Outflanked once more by the Guards Division's lightning advance down the west coast, through Port Swettenham and Port Dickson, the defences crumbled, and another shambolic retreat further south began. On the 16th of January, the remnants of the 11th Indian Division and the Australian 8th Division, under the command of General Gordon Bennett, made a spirited stand at the River Muar, where a final desperate attempt was made to dig in. Once more, the tanks rolled in and the artillery shells rained down, and the defenders were forced to break and retreat. Percival and his troops were now in an impossible position. With the fall of Endau on the east coast on the 16th of January, and with the bombs from Japanese aircraft flying from captured airfields adding to the growing number of casualties, there were now no further options. In less than 2 months, the Japanese had advanced through and captured more than 500 miles of British-held territory. With a heavy heart, Percival issued the order on the 25th of January to abandon Malaya and for a general retreat across the Johor Strait to the island of Singapore. In the early hours of the 1st of February, the last bedraggled and exhausted remnants of Percival's British and Empire troops made their way across the causeway linking Singapore to the Malayan mainland. The causeway was promptly blown up, removing the only land access to the island. Now more than 80,000 troops, including reinforcements from the 18th Division, had joined Singapore's 1 million civilians. But from which direction would the Japanese attack come? In an attempt to cover as many eventualities as possible, Percival decided to organize the defense of the island into three sectors. The northern area, which covered Singapore's northeast coast, was the area that Percival deemed most likely to face the main Japanese attack, and the fresh troops of the 18th Division were sent there to join the 11th Indian Division, the 8th Indian Brigade, and the 29th Australian Brigade. The western area, on the west coast of the island, was entrusted to the Australian 8th Division, together with the 44th Indian Brigade, and the southern area, which covered Singapore City, was given to the 1st and 2nd Malaya Brigades. Huge Japanese bombing raids on the island began on the 1st of February, attacks to which the British garrison had no answer. On the evening of the 7th of February, after nearly a week of waiting, the Guards Division made an attack across the Johor Strait towards the base at Changi. It was, however, a feint, a diversionary assault that drew British attention from the main attack that was made in the western sector the following night. The fighting here was desperate. Burning oil was floated down the Johor Strait by the British forces as the Japanese made their crossing, causing many casualties. Eventually, more than 10,000 Japanese troops fought their way into Singapore that night. Gradually, the British forces were pushed back towards the Tenga airfield. On the 9th of February, Japanese soldiers of the Guards Division attacked the western sector near Kranji, pushing the 29th Australian Brigade back from the area around the causeway. By the 11th of February, the important village of Bukit Timah was in Japanese hands, giving them effective control of the west side of the island. Crucially, they had also captured the all-important reservoirs in the middle of the island, its only source of fresh water. Having abandoned the naval base to the east of the causeway, the 11th Indian Division, 8th Indian Brigade, and British 18th Division also began to retreat towards Singapore City. With each passing hour, the Japanese noose was tightening, and so Lieutenant General Yamashita contacted Lieutenant General Percival to demand the surrender of the garrison. Percival refused. It was a futile gesture that may have cost many lives. On the 12th of February, British ships and boats tried to escape from the east of the island, only to be caught by Japanese Navy patrols. Many men were killed or wounded as the Japanese gunboats attacked. On the same day, Changi itself was abandoned, and the 1st and 2nd Malaya Brigades were withdrawn to form a perimeter with their comrades around Singapore City. Over the next 2 days, the defensive perimeter shrank even further as the Japanese pressed forward. On the morning of the 15th of February, a tired Percival finally called a conference with his commanders. There were few options left for the British forces now. A counterattack was briefly discussed, but rejected. What had changed to offer the prospect of its success? There were still 1 million civilians on the island, and some 130,000 troops. Supplies were dangerously low, and best estimates put the remaining fresh water but enough for only one more day. A protracted siege was therefore out of the question. Percival concluded that there was no alternative. He surrendered Singapore to Yamashita during the evening of the 15th of February. With the Japanese victory at Singapore, the sun set on the British Empire in the east, and the door was opened for further Japanese successes in the Pacific. Within a few weeks, the Dutch East Indies had collapsed, and Burma had been overrun, as the Japanese swept on to the Indian frontier. The Americans, too, were caught in the teeth of the Japanese storm, as despite a gallant defensive action that lasted 4 months, Bhutan surrendered in May 1942. 2,330 Americans, and perhaps 10,000 men in all, died of starvation, disease, or brutality during the subsequent forced march from Mariveles to San Fernando. This, along with the appalling cruelty to British prisoners in Burma, were the first examples of the Japanese soldiers' contempt for enemy troops who had surrendered rather than die in battle. Such barbarous episodes were to become a tragic feature of the Pacific War. On Singapore itself, 130,000 British and Empire troops passed into a harsh captivity that would last for 3.5 years. 8,500 men had been killed during the Japanese campaign. The civilian population suffered too, as the local Chinese were subjected to many painful indignities by their Japanese captors. There was nothing anyone could do, for now the initiative and the momentum was firmly with Japan. It would take years of toil, fighting, and sacrifice to wrest it from them. Back in Britain, hands were wrung and indignant questions were asked. How had this tragedy been allowed to come to pass? Naturally, the blame fell on the military, and particularly on General Percival, who was now in Japanese hands. The politicians who chorused their disapproval seemed less keen to remember or discuss the neglect, complacency, and ineptitude of the pre-war years, all of which had contributed to Singapore's downfall. However clever and determined the enemy, and however incompetent the politicians, the military were also responsible for the disaster. Singapore's defenses completely ignored the possibility of a land attack. The troops there were poor and ill-trained, and the entire garrison was badly equipped. 2 sunken battleships and hundreds of lives bore witness to the folly of sending a naval fleet to sea without air cover. And surely, never again would an enemy's fighting capabilities be so criminally underestimated. Those men who had orchestrated the extraordinary events in Malaya and Singapore were to experience mixed fortunes during the remainder of the war. Tomoyuki Yamashita eventually surrendered with what was left of his army at Baguio in September 1945. He was tried before a court in Manila and convicted of war crimes. And although he vehemently denied complicity in Japanese atrocities, the world was in no mood to listen. Yamashita, controversially, went to the gallows in February 1946. Arthur Percival, upon whose shoulders so much blame fell after the Malayan and Singapore debacle, survived Japanese captivity, and in a final sweet irony, was present at the eventual Japanese surrender in Tokyo Bay in 1945. He died in 1946. The capture of Singapore was but one in a string of Japanese successes which were the hallmark of their entry into the Second World War. It would not be long before their star would wane, just as Admiral Yamamoto had predicted before the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor. Soon, the Allies would find a way to turn back the tide and send Japan to a defeat that would end in an atomic nightmare. But under the hot Pacific sun during 1941 and 42, the world was introduced to the power of the land of the rising sun.